There's no one like you. believes in his presence. When you come in the presence of God, it's amazement. Because everything that God does, he leaves you standing in amaze of his awesomeness, of his greatness, of his works. You can't leave his presence feeling empty. Whenever you leave, you are filled with all of him. And because of it, because of his amazing love, is why we're here. We could have been elsewhere, but because of the amazing love of Jesus Christ, that's why I'm here, that's why you are here. Because of the amazement that he brings to our lives. Amazing love. Just love on Jesus tonight.
Jesus, Jesus, you're the one we love. that you would just breathe, oh God, on every person, oh Lord, that's feeling down. God, you are a miracle working God. And there is none like you. None like you, oh God. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Barbados, St. Lucia and St. Vincent and Grenada. Minister Dr. Catherine Payne, Global Mission Ministries Director of Hobart International, Bishop Winston Lee, National Overseer, Jamaica, Bishop Clarence Williams, National Overseer of the Turks and Caicos Islands of the Hobart, Minister Andrew Watts, Pastor of the Hoyts Village Church, Barbados, and his wife, Mrs. Natasha Watts, Bishop Fairwalter Eiffel, Administrative Assistant for Barbados, Pastor Dr. Marie Pierre, Administrative Assistant for St. Lucia, Bishop Richard Hopkins, Administrative Assistant for Grenada, Carrickpool, and Martinique, Pastor Sherilyn Dublin, Administrative Assistant for St. Vincent and the Grenadines, pastors, ministers, ministry leaders, auxiliary leaders, deacons, serving in the District of Barbados and the Windward Islands, specially invited guests, Celia Davis, Jamaica, Anne Marie Bryce of Georgia, USA, and members and friends of the Church of God of Prophecy. Good night. I greet you in the wonderful and all-powerful name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, our Lord, and soon coming King. Can you permit me to be more flexible in my welcome tonight? Do I have your permission?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Greatly appreciated. I am going to do a roll call, and as I call out the names of each country, I want the respective persons to respond to the call by belting out hallelujah. To all our guests outside these countries, feel free to join your voices with those of Barbados.
Amen.
Is that okay?
Amen.
But seriously, you made your choice. So, is Grenada in the house?
Hallelujah!
Amen. St. Lucia, are you in the house?
Hallelujah!
Amen. St. Vincent! Oh, Barbados. Amen, amen. It's indeed a pleasure for me now welcome all of you to the second night of the 23rd Biennial Regional Convention of the Church of God of Prophecy for the District of Barbados and the Windward Islands. The theme of the convention is United as One. In particular, I want to extend a very special welcome to the representatives of St. Lucia who arrived on the island late yesterday evening and in light of this was unable to participate in this assembly last night. Nevertheless, we thank God that you are here with us tonight. But we who were here last night, wow, what a time we had in the presence of the Lord. As King David wrote, in the presence of the Lord there is fullness of joy. Suitably, the night commenced with indigenous presentations from each country. They went on to the praise and worship segment. Then we heard the greetings from the invited dignitaries, as well as the performance of the mass choir. I had to put that in. They were excellent. I hope you got this band after this convention, please. And then came, as Barbados like St. Bajan phraseology or vernacular, seen on UK, the Word of God, based on a portion of Zechariah 3, in particular, verses 1 to 5 or thereabouts, and delivered by one of the featured speakers for the convention, Minister Dr. Payne. The Word was so rich. And we heard, to name a few points, about God preparing us so that we can adequately receive the Egyptian influences or mentality being evident in our lives, our relationships with each other, as well as God positioning us for for his will and glory. From all that was spoken, it's quite clear that God has prepared and positioned Dr. Payne to be a part of this convention. And in turn, he has prepared and positioned us to receive of his word. I want this to linger with you as it has lingered with me. Imagine Minister Payne, first time visitor to Barbados, and God's mouthpiece to position to speak unto us in this season. This should not be taken lightly. And we say thanks be unto our God. In essence, the tone of the convention was established last night. So as we come with expectant hearts tonight, we ask God to prepare and position us in order that we can receive of his Holy Spirit. May God continually bless and keep all of you, including me. Amen. Yes. Have a wonderful night.
We'll be right back. Thank you. tonight, and we're grateful to have with us all the way from Jamaica, Jamdum, Jamaica, Bishop Dr. Winston Lee. He is the national overseer of Jamaica. And we welcome you, Dr. Lee, to the convention which is about to come here in the Windward Islands and Barbados. We will invite you to read the convention at this moment. Amen.
Thank you very much. Greet the moderator for this evening's program, and also Bishop Payne and Sister Payne, regional overseers. Bishop Dr. Clayton Martin, ordained presbyter, and his wife, Sister Minister Dr. Sonia Martin. Also, Minister Dr. Kathy Payne, my friend. All the bishopric in the house, pastors, ministers, brothers and sisters, I use this opportunity to greet you well in the name of the Lord. It's good to be here in Barbados and to be among God's wonderful people. Only to know that I have a few Jamaican members here in this convention, and so happy to see all you wonderful people. God bless you, I love you, and I am enjoying the presence of the Lord, the richness of the saints, and I bless the Lord for my extended family this side of the Caribbean. However, I bring greetings also from the Throat and Thread congregations in Jamaica with approximately 37,000 members. They all tell me to say that they are praying for you and they love you. And if you want to visit a convention that you will see some things happening, you have got to come to the Jamaican convention. Amen. So, it's an invitation for you for 2021 to be with us. God bless you, love you, it's good to be here with you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Did somebody come with an empty cup? Amen. Did somebody come with a cup turned up to the Lord? Did somebody think, I had enough last night, that's okay, that can carry me for the rest of the week. Are there any hungry persons in this place tonight? Is there anyone who's going to say to the Lord, more Lord, more Lord, more Lord, God, I'm getting there, I'm getting there, I'm getting there, but I need a little more, Father, I need a little more, God. Let's bring the man of God before God today. Father, we worship you tonight. God, we exalt and glorify and magnify your holy and matchless name. Father, we need you. We need you in this time. We need you in this season. We need you, oh God. Father, we thank you for yesterday's word. Thank you. We need more of your word today, and so we bring your manservant to you, oh God. We bring Pastor Walks to you, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Oh, we pray for an impartation to him, oh God. So that he may impart to us, the Father, in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, hide him. Hide him. Holy Spirit, speak through him to us, oh God. We come to you asking you, oh God, what would you have of us, dear Lord? And so we wait expectantly upon you, what you would say for us so that we may move according to your command, the Father. God, you have your way, dear Lord God. And you be glorified through him, oh God. Speak to us tonight, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Because we need a word, oh God. We need a word. We need a word, Father. Speak to us, oh God. In Jesus' name, amen. Bishop Ivey will introduce our speaker.
Minister Andrew Watts was saved for approximately 18 years and served as the pastor of the Holy Spirit's Church of God and Prophecy since 2014. He's married to Natasha for the last 9 years, and he stole her heart when he came to the church 9 years ago. This local assembly that he is pastoring was virtually restarted after having been out of the community for a few years due to the demolition and rebuilding of his sanctuary. Prior to being called to the pastoral role, he was heavily involved in youth ministry at the same local church. And up to today, he and his wife, Natasha, lead the current youth ministries. Pastor Andrew has gone through church planting training with the Multiplication Network Ministries and is currently pursuing studies in that development. Pastor Andrew, and we're going to be needing him in this season, also serves on the executive of the St. James Central District Emergency Organization, a disaster emergency response agency in his constituency. Pastor Andrew has a background in sales and marketing, professional, and currently works in a business development with a Canadian-based executive recruitment firm. Ladies and gentlemen, let us stand as we welcome to the podium Pastor Andrew Watts.
Good night. I want to bring you greetings in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. I also wish at this time to clarify that I did not steal my wife's heart, but she gave it to me. The scriptures say that him who stole, steal no more. Thank God she's still giving it to me, and I'm thankful for God's grace. And I just want to greet you in the name of Jesus Christ. I want to welcome all of you who are from the other territories to Barbados and bring greetings from our local church as well, Hoyts Village. Yay! Amen. Amen. You can take your seats. After having coming behind the ladies who have either ministered or spoken on this mic, no, you are stuck with me, but I trust that God will bless you nonetheless. And I want to get to the Word of God, and I want to look at John chapter 17 and verse 20. I'm going to read a couple of verses. Probably read from verse 20 to verse 23. John chapter 17 and from verse 20. And the Word of God says, "Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you have sent me. And the glory which you gave me have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and thou in me, that they be made perfect or complete in one, and that the world may know that thou sent me and have loved them as thou loved them." Just to give some context to these few verses, because this occurs in John 17, it's the longest recorded prayer of Jesus. It's often referred to as his high priestly prayer. And in this prayer, he prays for himself. He prays for his immediate disciples, the 12, who will become his apostles, and he prays for us. Amen. And when he prays for himself in verse, that's contained in verse 1 to 5, he mentions this. He says, "Father, glorify me. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you." And he repeats this request with even more emphasis. He says, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began.
Yeah.
Next, he prays for his disciples. And one of the requests that he makes to the Father, he says, Father, keep true thine own name, those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. In other words, united as one. And then he prays for us, because it says, all them that shall believe on me through their word, and every single one of us who have believed on Jesus Christ, heard the gospel and answered in faith. And if we heard the gospel, then we heard their words. We heard what his apostles had wrote. We may have heard something from John, something from Matthew, something that Luke would have recorded, something Mark would have recorded, but we responded to the gospel. And the common theme throughout that prayer, again and again, is oneness. And more particularly, oneness as we are. And then he's referring to the relationship he has with the Father. There is a myth that the church can't work together. We want to put that to death. We want to put that to death, but that's not true. It's not true. And it's not true for these reasons. In verse 20, when Jesus prays for us, he makes two specific requests. He says that may all be one. Father, just as you are in me, and I am in you. The other request, he says, is that they may also be in us, so that the world may believe that you sent me. Yeah. The thing about it is that we proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ to the world. And scripture says that the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. In other words, it is powerful on its own by itself to bring men to saving faith. But the fact that Jesus in his prayer, and you must understand, if Jesus prayed this, it has been answered. Jesus in his prayer points out that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that he sent him. So in other words, our unity lends support, is a testimony, verifies that the gospel is true. The opposite must be true. And that if we are not united, then even though we proclaim a gospel that is powerful enough on its own to bring men to saving faith, we will leave questions in your mind. We will leave questions in your mind. But Jesus in this prayer says, he makes that request that they may also be in us, so that the world may believe you have sent me. Be in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Believing on Christ for salvation. Filled and indwelled with the Holy Spirit. In a loving relationship with the Father. This is necessary. He also speaks and testifies to the work he's done in us and something else that he's given to us. Because he says, I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. And then he states the result. And it's the result that answers his prayer request. The result is, then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. In other words, from God's side, we have all that we need to unite us one. We have. And any belief that we are as believers unable to unite is a myth. It's a myth. Because Jesus said he gave
And that's not light. You don't see many places in scripture where God says that he gave his glory to men. But in this verse, it says he gave his glory to how? And that's through his Holy Spirit. That's through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in each believer. And the one thing I can say for sure, I speak to a lot of believers both in the Church of God, prophecy, and outside, is that the Spirit of God in the believers is crying out for unity. Yeah. Crying out for unity in this body and beyond. Every year, the Spirit of God in the believers is crying out for unity. The good thing is that we have all that we need to be unity. That's the promise from God. Is a request by the Son of God, and as a matter of fact, he affirms that he gave us his glory. And so we are able to unite.
Amen.
We are able. And we must believe that. In faith, we must believe that. It is, I don't know if it's, if ironic will be the word, but in this particular hall right behind my head is a saying, unity is strength. And it, right underneath, it has, without vision, the people perish. And that's a popular sin. The thing about it, though, is half a verse. It's half of a verse. Proverbs 29 and verse 18, but the other half goes on to say, happy or blessed is he that keeps the law of God.
Yeah.
We don't often hear the other half. But that's the truth. And so the word of God is something that we must believe. And believing that we have all that we need to unite is essential.
Amen.
We need that. We need that. Joel chapter 14 and verse 15 says, this is Jesus speaking. He says, if you love me, keep my commands. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever. The Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. And that's the promise that we currently receive. That's the promise that we currently walk in. And so we have all that we need to unite. But sometimes we if. And that's a Barbadian saying, but in context, to if is synonymous with bluffing, with procrastinating. In other words, you look like, but you never actually do. You're posturing, but you never actually perform. You look like, but you never actually do it. You're bluffing, but you never actually be. Since we can't if, we must be. We can't if, we must be. And it must start with a deep conviction that we are able, through God, to unite. And that what will unite us is the Spirit of God in the people of God working together for the glory of God.
Amen.
And that's the ultimate result. For the glory of God. Because here's the thing, why this particular half of a verse is kind of strange sometimes, because when you think about the Tower of Babel, people who were together, they were united. And they were not confused about their intentions. Their intention was to build a tower lest we be scattered across the earth. The problem is that God had commanded, multiply, replenish the earth, fill the earth. So it was a direct contradiction to the word of God. But yes, they were together. And they had a clear vision. But it was contrary to God's will.
Amen.
And that's it. Because we must believe as we unite. And I know this also does speak to leaders as well. As we unite, we must be very sure that we have a God-given vision.
Amen.
Because the thing is, a job, a task, a mission can't be executed by yourself. And if it's not a God-given vision for the ones tasked with executing it, it becomes a nightmare. A real nightmare. But if God is in it, we will see this. No, no, no. If God is in it, we will see blessing.
Amen.
And so he's given us on one side anything that we need to unite. But unity has a lot to do with working with one another.
Yes.
It would be easy if you could have unite without actually working alongside, depending on needing the input from someone else. And the scriptures has also given us some direction concerning that. Ephesians chapter 4. And from, I just want to read Ephesians chapter 4, those first three verses. This is Paul writing, and it says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And further down, he will talk about the gifts given to the church: apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, evangelists. And if you can look though at these first three verses almost as a code of conduct. As a code of conduct of how we minister and build up one another. And what you see there is lowliness, meekness, or humility, not exalting oneself above the other. Forbearing. If you're forbearing, it means you're going to be given a second chance at least. You're going to be given a second chance at least. If you're forbearing, long suffering. We don't like that. But as a matter of fact, it's part of the fruit of the Spirit. So it is going to be, or has been, or is being, our experience, because Christ's character must be formed in us.
Yeah.
But that's here. It's amazing because when Paul goes on to talk about the gifts given to the church and the functions thereof, and he talks about apostles, prophets, evangelists, teachers, preachers, and across the body of Christ, these particular functions cause so much division.
Yes.
And the question is it fivefold, fourfold, is it tenfold? So much division. But I believe and I know that we must know this. Whether a fivefold, fourfold, or tenfold, if we unfold this five, and we unfold this five, and we direct our requests to God, nothing doubting, he will answer. He's promised that what we believe that he is, and he's a reward of them who seek him, he will answer. And so, we must remember, yes, from one side, God has given all that we need to be united. And so we can't think about that. We must believe, first of all. We can't think. We must be. But then working and ministering alongside or to one another, then there's some direction. Lowliness. Meekness. Long suffering. Forbearance. It must be there. It must be there. That's part of it. And so we can't aim at that. It means that sometimes if there's forbearing, there has to be a reason to forbear. So it means then that offense is going to come. Misunderstanding is going to happen. Long suffering suggests that a problem doesn't get fixed immediately. A concern doesn't get answered right away. Else that wouldn't be necessary. And it's forbearing one another in love. Not compromise. Not nepotism, not a friends and family kind of thing. But in love. In love. And so even then, as we work together, we can't if. We must be. We can't allow maybe a personality. Yes, we could work together if that personality was gone. We could work together if so-and-so was more consistent. We could get work together if such-and-such did a mess. We could work together if and only when this or that condition is finally over. No, we cannot be. We must be. We must be. We must be able to work together under these conditions and look at it almost like a code of honor. Lowliness, humbleness or meekness, long suffering, forbearance, with forgiveness is included, patience is included. But we can do this. And we can do it. Why? Because God, from His side, through His Holy Spirit, answering the requests of the Son of God, has given and deposited in us His glory. His glory. But it comes out through unity. And so we can't if act. We must be united. We must be. God is able to short hold the issues that may arise. He's able, by the Spirit of God, to give us the grace to endure long suffering. Give us the grace to forbear with one another. Which means that you're going to give someone another chance, another opportunity. The ability to be humble. Not exalting oneself, but being humble. Being humble. And that is part of being united. And the promise of God is, according to Scripture, then the world will know that Christ was really sent. Then the world will know that God loves us the same as He loved Christ. Then the world will know. Isn't that, will we love that to be our reality? Will we love it that persons can look, and by the way, I quite understand that regulatory your mission is for the kingdom of God and not a denomination, but would you like it where persons can look at this body and say one thing about those people? They love one another. They love one another. Because the reality is that the world is full of posturing. Look like, but not really. Full of posturing. Full of bluffing, but not really being. And persons long to see and experience genuine, sacrificial love. Love that goes beyond just liking a certain personality, that goes beyond, and by the way, unity is not uniformity. I know uniformity very well. The background of the faith, well, the religion, or what you want to call it, that I was raised in, was uniformity. Everybody did the same thing. As a matter of fact, on certain occasions, they wore the same thing. But it wasn't uniformity. It wasn't unity, sorry. It was just uniformity. It was because there were consequences and there were rewards. And persons deemed the rewards greater than the consequences of not adhering. And they did it. But it wasn't a matter of unity. It was uniformity. And we see that even now. We know that some bodies that are pointed out as being unified are really not. They're uniform, but not unified. But for us, if the Spirit of God is given way to in our lives. Real unity must take place. Real unity must take place. And we know that it can be done. So we don't have to be fat. We cannot be. We must be. We must be. Because God from His side has given to us all that we need to be. All that we need to be. He will assist us in our endeavors. He will assist us in our mission. He will assist us in our plans. Oftentimes, when it comes to planning and faith are almost juxtaposed, like opposites. Like if one is here and the other is here and they never meet. But that's not true. That's not true. Because faith is the substance of things hoped, the evidence of things not seen. So when a vision is articulated and then it's written, then it's further substantiated. What is hoped for is further substantiated. The evidence of something we're not yet seeing is greater. When analysis and research is done, by faith, then the substance of what we hope for is substantiated. What we hope for really is substantiated. And greater evidence is there of something we've not yet seen. When we analyze the resources necessary to do the complete a mission, then the substance of what we hope for is there. The evidence of something not yet seen is a little greater. When we analyze our ability or maybe our strengths or weaknesses in relation to accomplishing a mission that we've united to do, well then, what we hope for is further substantiated. By faith, there is more evidence of something not yet seen. When we gather together those things who are able, redeemed able, and whom God has called, and who God has moved upon to accomplish a mission that leadership may have put forward, then what we hope for is further substantiated. There is greater evidence of something not yet seen. And when we actually engage in the work, then we've added and proven that our faith is not without works. And therefore, what we hope for is further substantiated by actual action. The evidence now is beginning to be seen. And then when we give a timely, accurate progress report or review, then what we hope for is even greater substantiated. The evidence is not only seen, but we know whether we're making progress at the intended rate. And so planning and faith go hand in hand. By faith, we will submit to leadership. By faith, execute. By faith, plan. By faith, research. By faith, compile. By faith, gather together a team. By faith, actually get into action. By faith, measure our effectiveness. By faith, it's not opposite to faith. But God, by faith, is calling us. It's calling us. So we don't if. So we don't if. You see, and I'm glad that I'm a Caribbean person, because one thing I can say, not me necessarily, but Caribbean people are gifted communicators. And so when a vision or mission is articulated, faith rises. We hear that and faith rises on the inside. We rejoice. There's a confidence that we will execute on what is being said. But
But there's also some prayer that has to go with that. God needs some prayer. When faith rises, we feel good. Rightly so. And I'm talking about real faith, not excitement. I mean real faith. When faith rises and we believe that we can execute on a mission or a vision, it feels good. And we jump, we skip, we shout, and God is glorified in our prayers. But then at some point, also God does something work. Also want to do something more. And the truth is that oftentimes the ones who go up are not necessarily the ones who get down. But it's gonna happen to you. And we gotta be dependent on God step by step. Step by step. Without vision the people perish. But that's a big one. Happy is he who obeys. And God has promised that he will answer every faithful prayer. He's promised, as a matter of fact, that when two or three are gathered together, he's in the midst. And we make our requests known, and he answers them. This is a lot more than two or three. This is a lot more than two or three. And we can make some requests known tonight, but this is a lot more than two or three.
Amen.
You know, I know there's so many things in our region for which we have to pray about. Really, 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 really pray about. So many things which are dependent, really, circumstances which affect our mission as a church that we have to pray about. Even we are an original convention in Barbados, and I understand and know that it was not easy for everyone to get here. Airline fees are not cheap. They're not. And maybe one thing we can pray about is that, competitively priced airline will arise in this Windward Islands that we can travel to or from at better rates. Recent events lead me to believe that that may be on the horizon, but we don't want them on the horizon. We want them on the horizon. So we want to pray. We want to trust God that this happens. I mean, this is just being practical. This is real. We want to trust God, but we must unite, but we can't if. We must be united. We can't if. There's a million and one things that if our minds dwell on them, prevent us from being united, but we can't if. We must be, because we have, according to scripture, been given the glory of God through the Spirit of God on the inside of the people of God. And so we are able to unite together on the mission and work of God through the glory of God. It's the truth. It's the truth. We can. And most of all, I want us to bury any thought that we can't do. Amen. Could even have a second assignment to that. One done. We can, if we must be united as a people. Then we see things happen. What would unity, real unity, look like? What would a people who believe that God has given all that we need to unite look like? What would a people determined not to live, but to be united, look like? It could look like, and I know this is a fact, a renewed push towards evangelism, but one in which we recognize that we are all in this together. I'm not familiar with the name to geography of every church from every other island, but I am in Barbados, one that realizes that if one's village needs to be evangelized, that is actually a mission of the Church of God of Prophecy. Yeah. One that realizes that if Cavefield needs to be evangelized, that's the mission of the Church of God of Prophecy. Yeah. One that would realize that there should be no problem at all. And I know there isn't,
but greater still must be our unity in coming together in evangelistic work, even. And by that we fulfill one of our core values, by the way, harvest. What would it look like? The reality is, in any, and I can speak for Barbados, in any neighborhood in Barbados, on any block, if 20 spirit-filled men of God turn up, they will get notice. Persons will sit up and take notice. Imagine it's not like a smaller person, but somebody like Brother Neil, for instance. And 20 and 19 more, they will get notice. First of all. And then we deliver on the mission that we have. Spreading the word of God, giving the gospel of their salvation, calling men to penitent faith in Jesus Christ. United as one in harvest. I mentioned prayer before. I mean, seriously, can we pray that we get a more competitive year of prayer? Seriously speaking, that I'm united as one in prayer. But that's another word. What would it look like? But because of our faithful stewardship thus far, this church is in a position to even venture into other enterprises which provide consistent business-based income, consistent, not event-based sporadic income, but consistent business-based income. What would that look like? Because stewardship must be more than faithful tithing, but it's absolutely. It does not stay. But it's how we handle the resources to the glory of God. What would it look like? It could look like us getting involved in such ventures. Maybe nurseries. Maybe real estate. It could look like those responsible would say what it will look like, but it could look like part of stewardship too. But for sure, we have to be united as one to accomplish. We must be. What will it look like when we even look at evangelism? Not only feet on the ground, face to face, but even across social media platforms. What would it look like when young persons, youth, are given that mandate to spread the word of God in creative and innovative ways across the platform that persons are actually paying attention to? What would that look like? It would mean that they must know and be training what they're actually going to proclaim. That's development. And they would lead that charge, that's leadership. What would that look like? But we must unite as one for that to happen. The good thing is that God has given us all that we need. And then he's given us a code of conduct in how to proceed. Lowliness, meekness, long suffering, forbearing one another in love. All that we need, how to proceed, and a promise made to his initial disciples, but one which holds to us, he will be with us always, as long as we're on this mission. Church, saints, we cannot live. We cannot live. We must be. We can't live. We must be. Because we have all that God has provided for us to be. And the how to, the directions, the how to proceed, given to us. And so we can if we must be. tonight is a good night because you get to go home early. But before you go home early, can we stand? Can we unite this morning in prayer? As God has granted us this opportunity in solidarity, Lord, can we hold another's hand as a sign of unity and help by the hand? Believe, call in prayer. These promises given us everything. Can we believe together in prayer? Father, we thank you for your Holy Spirit, first of all. We thank you for such a gift, such an inheritance. We thank you, O God, that you have clothed us with compassion. You've clothed us with power by your Holy Spirit, but you're clothing us with compassion so that another's burden becomes our burden. Another's pain is our pain. Another journey is our journey. And so we stand here tonight, God, holding hands, not as a form, not as posturing, but being united. Father, work on our hearts that we can genuinely be united. Convict us of the truth of your word, that you gave us your glory, that we are wanting you, that we have fellowship with you, Father. I'm the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm the Holy Spirit. Fellowship meaning going together in the same direction with the same intent. We were challenged last night not to ask that you would go with us, but to go with you where you lead. Father, we refuse to aid. We will be. We submit to you, O God, to your leading. We submit to you, O God. We submit to you. We submit to you, Father. We acknowledge the truth that you have given us. Not a spirit of fear, but of love, power, soundness of my wisdom. We ask for your help. When we return here, God willing, should Christ delay in another 24 months, that we will see the difference. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise God. We want to continue to pray for Brother Walks, Pastor Walks, as he will continue to allow the Lord to position him as he so needs. Amen.
Dynamic speakers, pouring words, dozens of leaders from across the region. My name is Michelle Robinson, and you're watching Blue Shore Media Television for the Church of God of Prophecy 23rd Biennial Regional Convention of Barbados and the Windward Islands. The theme scripture for this year is John 13:35. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you